Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio questions is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. Should any member wish to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. As ever, succinct questions and answers to match are much appreciated to ensure that we can get in as many members as possible. And I call question number one, Claire Hoghey.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact on workers in Scotland of an independent Scotland rejoining the European Union.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government believes that the best future for Scotland is as an independent country, which is a member state of the European Union. We set out the multiple benefits that rejoining the EU as an independent country would bring to workers in the third paper of the independence prospectus, including greater mobility to work in any EU country, fairer labour market, better regulation and protection of workers' rights. We'll continue to build the case for a socially just, independent Scotland within the EU and give the people of Scotland the information that they need to make an informed choice about whether Scotland should become an independent country.
Claire Hoghey.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware of the recent findings by the Centre for European Reform, which predicts that the average worker will be £1,300 worse off as a result of Brexit. Despite Scotland voting overwhelmingly to remain, being forced out of the EU against our will is hitting workers hard in the pocket. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that the Tories, and Labour for that matter, must answer as to why workers in Scotland are being forced to pay such a heavy price for their Brexit obsession?
Cabinet Secretary.
I wholeheartedly agree with Claire Hoghey, the UK Government, and for that matter, with the support of the UK Labour Party, has imposed an unnecessarily hard Brexit, which is having a damaging impact on businesses and workers in Scotland and making the cost of living crisis so much harder to bear. The Office for Budget Responsibility expects that the UK's GDP will be 4% lower in the long run. That's the equivalent of around £100 billion in lost output, which will damage employment prospects for workers. This further demonstrates why securing independence and getting back into the EU, a market which by population is 7 times the size of the UK, is essential for the future well-being of people in Scotland.
And supplementary, Sharon Dowd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Earlier this month, the President of the SNP and former Constitution Secretary, Mike Russell, told the Herald newspaper, and I quote, "I don't think independence can be secured right now." In light of that statement, why is the SNP government wasting time contemplating such hypothetical situations instead of focusing on the real and present priorities of the Scottish people?
Cabinet Secretary.
It shouldn't come as a surprise to Sharon Dowie. In fact, it shouldn't come to a surprise to any members on the Conservative benches, having lost the last Scottish Parliament election, that the parties that won the election were elected on a manifesto to hold a democratic referendum in Scotland. Now, there is no technical reason why the UK government cannot transfer the responsibilities to have a referendum. It is, after all, the policy favoured by the majority of MSPs in this Parliament. So it would be entirely incorrect and false for this government to not make the necessary preparations. We want the people to be as informed as possible. And I would hope that Democrats would all agree that if a government is elected to do something, it should be able to get on with it.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
I think I must be getting a bit deaf in my old age, but I didn't hear the Minister set out what the impact of leaving the UK internal market would be on those very same workers. Why is he embracing the obvious benefits of the European Union, but ignoring the problems caused by the breakup of the United Kingdom?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, all I can say to Willie Rennie, there's nobody on these benches who is a tectonic separatist. We're in favour of the best possible trading relations across these islands, but we also want to be part of the biggest single market in the world, which is the European Union single market. I'm not one of those, perhaps he is, who is pleading for Scotland to remain dependent on a single market the size of the United Kingdom. Why not embrace the credible historic European support of the Liberal Democrats for the European idea and join us on these benches by seeking our place within the European single market?
Question number two, Jamie Green.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported comments by the Edinburgh Festival Fringe Society Chief Executive that the festival faces an existential threat.
Minister Christina McKelvey.
Thank you, President Officer. The Edinburgh Fringe Festival is a top cultural brand in Scotland, attracting global talent every year. The Scottish Government acknowledges the challenges the cultural and events sector, including the Fringe, has faced during the pandemic, Brexit, lower audience numbers and high energy costs. To support the Fringe resilience and long-term viability, the Scottish Government has offered a combination of loans and grants, recognising the festival's importance to Scotland's cultural scene. We aim to keep working with the Fringe Society and the wider culture and events sector to understand how to provide support during these very trying times.
Jamie Green.
Can I thank the Minister for that response? I'm sure the grants will be welcome, perhaps the loans less so, but I hope she will join me in welcoming the £8.6 million pledged by the UK Government for Scotland's festival economy, which I hope will create a permanent headquarters for the Fringe in Edinburgh and also create year-round opportunities for artists and local talent. But we should acknowledge it's not just Edinburgh that celebrates culture. I'd like to hear what the Scottish Government is doing outside of the Central Belt to support regions like my own in the West and rural communities to ensure there's a vibrant cultural scene right throughout Scotland that isn't dependent on large tourism numbers such as the capital does.
Minister.
Thanks very much, and thanks for that supplementary. Jamie Green, I hope, will also welcome the announcement by the Scottish Government on the commitments, financial commitments that we've made over the past few weeks to the cultural sector in the ongoing months and years to come. We have been urging the UK Government to recognise the valuable role Scotland's culture sector plays to the Scottish and UK economy. Therefore, any additional funding from the spring budget is welcome. While the funding is welcome, the UK Government needs to engage with us in advance to ensure support is aligned and its impact maximised. And we do understand that the £7 million of that award is subject to a business case being agreed by DCMS, and we don't have that yet. And it's for capital expenditure to assist the Fringe Society in finding a new home that can offer year-round support to local artists and communities like the one Mr Green represents. Sorry about that.
Question number three, not lodged. Question number four, withdrawn. Question number five, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how the Scottish Connections Framework will help to address any demographic challenges.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Connections Framework seeks to expand links and networks with Scottish people and those with an association to Scotland living elsewhere in the world. Scotland has particular challenges with all our future population growth forecast expected to come from migration, which is one of the reasons the Scottish Government is so concerned at the UK Government's approach to migration. Migration is therefore an issue which is crucial for Scotland's future economic and social well-being. Activity under the framework will allow the Scottish Government to project Scotland's attractiveness as a place to work, to live, to study and to do business. This will include promoting the Talent Attraction and Migration Service, which we aim to launch later in 2023.
Stephanie Callaghan.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Does he agree that encouraging young talent to immigrate to Scotland will help address Scotland's demographic challenges and support our economy and public services? And can he outline how the Talent Attraction and Migration Service, which I know will be launched this year, plans to encourage immigration and retention of young people in areas of Scotland where tourism is not as prevalent?
Cabinet Secretary.
In 2021, the Ministerial Population Task Force published Scotland's first population strategy, a key building block of which is to ensure that Scotland is an attractive and also a welcoming country. Inward migration supports our communities, strengthens our public services and grows our economy. The Talent Attraction and Migration Service will encourage more people to come and live in Scotland. It will help employees navigate the UK government's complex and sadly bureaucratic immigration rules to help meet their skills needs. The service will provide good quality information and advice to help people move here and settle into their communities.
And supplementary, Ivan McKee.
Thank you, President Austin. While there are restrictions on what the Scottish Government can do through the Connections Framework and their other work to address demographic challenges through international immigration due to its reserved nature, there are no restrictions on addressing demographic challenges through attracting people from the rest of the UK to come and live and work in Scotland. Can I ask what the Scottish Government is doing to take forward the work of the industry group on UK talent attraction already existing to address demographic challenges and increase Scotland's tax revenues?
Cabinet Secretary.
Ivan McKee raises some very important issues there, and the Scottish Government is taking action to attract people with the skills that Scotland needs from the rest of the United Kingdom. Our UK talent attraction programme will continue to be informed and supported by the Industry Advisory Group. As a priority action, we are working with the group to develop an aerospace and space sector talent attraction pilot that includes the implementation of a recruitment toolkit and of marketing activity. But people moving from the rest of the United Kingdom to Scotland are extremely welcome.
Question number six, Ben McPherson.
To ask the Scottish Government what engagement it and its agencies have had with Leith Theatre.
Minister.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. Can I just thank Ben McPherson for the legacy in which he left in this role that I now take over, and many of the stakeholders have been asking after Mr McPherson, and I just wanted to pass that on. In December, the Cabinet Secretary for Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, Angus Robertson, chaired a Cultural Resilience Roundtable that I'm very pleased to say that Leith Theatre participated in. During the height of the pandemic, Leith Theatre received £538,000 from a Performing Arts Venue Relief Fund and Recovery Fund, and Creative Scotland have had engagement with the organisation and the artists who have presented work at Leith Theatre on a case-by-case basis.
Ben McPherson.
I thank the Minister for her kind words and also for that expansive answer highlighting the good work of Leith Theatre. Does the Scottish Government agree with me that Leith Theatre has an important role to play in assisting the Edinburgh festivals in widening their impact throughout the city of Edinburgh and its communities? And would the Culture Ministers agree to visit Leith Theatre in the period ahead to learn more about its artistic facilities, its community work and its plans for the future?
Minister.
Thank you very much. I do acknowledge the important role that Leith Theatre has played in Edinburgh's festivals, including the successful hosting of numerous contemporary music events at last year's Edinburgh International Festival. Leith Theatre is part of Edinburgh's rich theatre landscape, and I am sure that festival organisers hear the great case that the member is making for Leith Theatre as a venue. I would also invite the member to send me some additional information on the exciting work happening at Leith Theatre, and I'll gladly consider a visit to the theatre with him.
Question number seven, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the Historic Environment Scotland sites that remain closed.
Minister.
Yep. Historic Environment Scotland has recently announced the reopening of more than 20 properties in care as part of its seasonal reopenings. It has also fully reopened or increased access at more than 40 sites as part of its high-level masonry programme of inspections. The first batch of inspections was completed in summer last year, and the work is progressing very well on the next batch. However, I have asked Historic Environment Scotland to write to the member with a fuller answer to her question.
Sue Webber.
I thank the Minister for that response. She'll know that in 2022, Linlithgow Palace had to close due to those masonry inspections that Historic Environment Scotland carried out. And it is hoped very much that it will reopen this summer, but only partially. It's also recently been victim to vandalism, with conservation teams working to assess this damage, which will no doubt be costly to repair and require experts to carry out the work. Can the Minister assure me that the closure and lack of full accessibility will not adversely affect Linlithgow's local economy and tourism industry, and confirm that the recent vandalism won't hinder its partial reopening date?
Minister.
As I said, Presiding Officer, I think I'll get Historic Environment Scotland to write on the particular details about timing. I don't have that information to hand, but I do condemn the vandalism at Linlithgow Palace. We do want the programme of assessment going forward to enable all of these attractions to be opened fully, but we have to obviously err on the side of caution and be safe about that. But as I said in the original answer, we are making great progress on that work, and I'll have Hess write to Sue Webber on that. I think the Scottish Government, it should be known, takes heritage crime very, very seriously, and with specific legislation in place to protect nationally significant historic spaces, heritage crime can rob us of our history. And I think, you know, Linlithgow Palace and other places have had enough to deal with over the past few years with the issues that they've been experienced through the pandemic and the cost of living crisis. But to then be vandalised is just not acceptable.
Yeah. Supplementaries, Fiona Hislop.
I would also be interested in seeing that reply. And does the Minister agree with me that the vandalism which took place on 30th, 20th of April at the historic Linlithgow Palace in my constituency is of great concern and highlights the danger of leaving properties closed, attracting antisocial behaviour and, in some cases, a heritage crime, and that the reopening of properties doesn't just have a heritage and tourism role, they also need to be reopened to promote responsibility around these sites.
Minister.
Yep, as I said in the previous answer, I will ensure that that advice from HES goes to both members asking questions today. I think this act of vandalism in particular, and any vandalism in our historic sites, is completely unacceptable. And I know the incident is subject to a police investigation, so I'll not say much more on that as we speak right now. But as I did say, heritage crime can rob us of not just our history, but some of the learning for our children in the future as well. And its impact on communities is absolutely enormous. So in my new role, I will discuss closely with Historic Environment Scotland the current safety-related closures at the property and the care and the impacts of the vandalism, and report back to both members on that issue. Thank you.
Supplementary, Donald Cameron.
Thank you. And can I, on behalf of these benches, welcome the Minister to her new role. I previously asked her predecessor, Neil Gray, about two particular sites in the Highlands and Islands, one being Kismul Castle on Barra, and the other the Bon Or Iron Furnace in Argyll, both of which I believe remain temporarily closed. Could she give Parliament an update on those sites? And does she recognise the damage to the local economy, especially the tourist economy, of sites across Scotland remaining closed to the public?
Minister.
Yeah, I don't have details on those particular sites, but again, I will get those details and get those to Donald Cameron. And thank you so much for your good wishes. I'm looking forward to working on this work. I think it's important to say that we have substantially increased our resources to Historic Environment Scotland in recognition of the impact of not just the pandemic, but all of the other issues, particularly the impact on their commercial income. So the quicker we can get the assessments done, the quicker we get these places open, and the quicker that then has an impact on local economies. And I will, again, get the most up-to-date information that I can for Donald Cameron on the two particular sites that he mentions.
And supplementary, Fozil Chechik.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would also like to congratulate the Minister on your new role. At the end of last year, the Scottish Government's budget predicted a forecast increase in commercial revenue for Historic Environment Scotland. However, at the beginning of this year, 60 Historic Environment Scotland sites remain closed or permanently closed for the public. Can the Minister advise how Historic Environment Scotland's revenue will raise as predicted if so many of these sites remain closed throughout the summer?
Minister.
Yeah, I think this ties into the answers to the other questions there and the impact that both the pandemic and the cost of living crisis has had on these particular attractions, but also on the issues around about the safety and the inspection work that needs to be done. As I said, we've completed one tranche. We're well on our way in completing the other tranche. And again, that has an impact on the revenue in which these attractions can incur. We have supported Historic Environment Scotland with £72.7 million to maintain Scotland's heritage and historic environment, which is 0.6% higher than the £39 million level of support before the impact of the pandemic in 2019-2020. I would hope that will reassure the member that we have given that financial commitment, but I have also given the commitment to work very closely with Historic Environment Scotland to ensure that we can get all of these, if not partially opened, but opened completely as well.
Question number 8, Graeme Simpson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Constitution Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding engagement with the UK Government on a potential return to the Horizon Europe research programme.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish Ministers have been clear in their communications that association to Horizon Europe is a matter of utmost importance to Scotland and is the best option for the Scottish research and innovation sector. Given the cross-cutting nature of Horizon Europe, many Scottish Ministers have an interest and engage with their UK and devolved counterparts on this issue. I myself attended the UK-EU Relations Interministerial Group meeting on the 20th of March, where I raised the importance of UK association to Horizon Europe ahead of observing the Trade and Cooperation Agreement Partnership Council meeting between the UK and the EU on the 24th of March. The Scottish Government will continue to work together to ensure Scotland's interests and needs are supported as negotiations are taken forward on EU programmes.
Graeme Simpson.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? He pledged to press for a return to the programme in last week's programme for government document. So he'll be aware that this is exactly the outcome that the UK government seeks, but it must be a good deal for the UK. And if that's not possible, then there's the alternative Pioneer plan, which is backed, should it be required, by the Russell Group and others. So will the Cabinet Secretary commit to working with the UK government on both the Horizon or Pioneer for the benefit of research and development across these islands?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the simple answer to that question is yes. I have been working with UK ministerial counterparts in two recent meetings, the most recent which I attended with Foreign Secretary James Cleverly and Mario Sefcovic, in relation to a number of normalisations that we would hope after progress in Northern Ireland. And I give him and colleagues a commitment that we do really want to see a return to the Horizon programme. I would just make one minor point in relation to all of this, of course, which is we wouldn't be in any of this difficulty if the UK hadn't left the European Union, and if we, as we voted for in Scotland, had been able to remain in the European Union, we wouldn't be in the difficulty that we are now trying to dig ourselves out of.
Supplementary, Alistair Allen.
As the Cabinet Secretary has indicated, the situation with Horizon Europe is a product of an unwanted Brexit, but does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the UK government should see Horizon Europe as part of a process of reopening more doors to our European neighbours, by, for example, also scrapping the disastrous retained EU law bill and remaining aligned with high EU standards?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Alistair Allen is absolutely right in this. Brexit is, of course, an act of unmitigated self-harm by the UK government, and it represents a generational disaster for Scotland. Mitigating its impact is a priority for this government, and until we are able to rejoin the European Union as an independent nation, we're going to have to deal with issues like the retained EU law bill, which is reckless. It damages legislation that needlessly puts at risk vital protections and standards. It should be withdrawn by the UK government. Scotland will continue to align as closely as we can with the safeguards and the standards that we benefited from as part of the European Union. And as to Horizon, Scottish ministers have been clear consistently that association is a matter of significant importance to the research sector in Scotland.
Supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
I thank the Minister for his answer to those questions, and I welcome the conversations that he's having with the government to rejoin. But if Scotland is able to rejoin one European Union programme like Horizon, why is it not making progress towards a replacement for others, such as the Erasmus programme, as has been done in Labour-run Wales, to allow students to come here to study and to allow our own students the valuable opportunity to study abroad?
Cabinet Secretary.
Frankly, the best way to protect our place in European programmes is to be in the European Union. The last time I looked, the UK Labour Party is supporting the Conservative Party in the UK remaining outside the European Union. This is a statement of fact, and one is going to hear a lot of that in the months and the years to come. Of course, we should be seeking mitigation wherever we can, but we have to aspire to more than mitigation. So yes, let us do everything that we can do in relation to the Horizon programme. Yes, we need to do everything that we can in relation to student mobility across the European Union. But please, let's not wave a white flag of surrender, keep ourselves outside the European Union and suffer this damage. Please, Labour Party in Scotland, why don't you return to your pro-European roots and support Scotland rejoining the European Union where it should be?
And supplementary briefly, please, Beatrice Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This should be an easy fix given the Windsor framework is now agreed. Has the Cabinet Secretary established what the barriers are in his discussions with UK and EU ministers to ensure that the Horizon research programme that students aren't going to miss out on the Horizon research programme?
To be frank to Beatrice Wishart, I think the biggest blockage, the biggest impediment to progress related to the state of negotiations around Northern Ireland, the threat by the UK government to break international law, to break international treaties as part of the appalling relations and gunboat diplomacy that it was pursuing in past months. We have now moved beyond that, thank goodness for that, And as I previously mentioned to a question on the Conservative benches, having sat in on a meeting between James Cleverly and Mara Sefcovic, that there is reason to believe that now we have got beyond that stage, progress can be made. So we will do everything that we can when we meet with UK government colleagues to impress on them the importance of making progress. But to be honest, the biggest impediment that there has been to date has been the appalling relations between the UK government and the European Union. Hopefully we are beyond that now.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We'll now move to the next portfolio, which is Justice and Veterans. I call question number one, John Mason.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will consider making proven and not proven the two available verdicts in the criminal courts.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill introduced yesterday proposes to abolish the not proven verdict and introduce a two-verdict system of guilty and not guilty. This decision was based on significant high-quality evidence and extensive stakeholder engagement during the consultation and policy development process. The alternatives of introducing verdicts of proven and not proven was considered, and engagement made clear that guilty and not guilty are unambiguous and easier to understand than the alternatives of proven and not proven. They are familiar verdicts that provide greater clarity and have been proven to work well in other jurisdictions.
John Mason.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, and I note the point that she feels they are guilty and not guilty are more easily understood. But I wonder if she would accept that not proven is a more honest verdict than not guilty. After all, someone might have committed the crime, but there's not enough evidence, or they've got off on a technicality. So not guilty is surely a subset of not proven, but not proven includes other possibilities too.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it is important that we explain why we support the two-verdict system of guilty and not guilty. And in many regards, Mr Mason's questioning demonstrates some of the difficulties with the not proven and proven alternative. And our evidence is clear that the not proven verdict is not understood by jurors, can cause stigma for the acquitted and trauma for complainers. And our consultation demonstrated 50% of respondents favoured guilty and not guilty, compared to 41% for proven and not proven. Support for guilty and not guilty was particularly strong among legal organisations and those third sector organisations, particularly those who support victims and their families. And for example, the senators of the College of Justice commented in their response that the two verdicts available ought to be guilty and not guilty. These are commonly understood concepts which are applied throughout every other English-speaking jurisdiction.
Supplementary, Jamie Green.
Thank you. The Victims Bill published today, it's an excellent name for a bill, I should add, as well as removing the not proven verdict, also proposes one other major change, which is the reduction of jury sizes and the numbers required for a majority verdict. This is quite a substantial change to how decisions are made about whether someone is convicted or not. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, what was the thought process that went behind that proposal? What consultation took place that said that that was the right proposal and direction travel to take? But more importantly, what did the modelling say about the effect that would have on the outcomes of trials? Because ultimately, that is the key to its success or otherwise.
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Mr Green for his question. It is important that I reassure him that extensive consultation has underpinned this bill, in particular in terms of the work that has been undertaken by the Victims Task Force. And there has also been significant research undertaken in and around matters impacting on juries, both in Scotland and across the developed world. It is important to stress that matters of verdict, jury size and majority are all very closely related and interlinked. It is important for us to maintain a balanced approach and to consider those matters in the round. And while there are other aspects of the bill that are very focused on improving the experience for victims and survivors, and a pilot to address some of the long-standing concerns that we've had about conviction rates for the most serious of sexual offences, including rape. The issues in and around jury size and not proven are not designed to influence conviction rates, because the not proven and the jury size and the jury majority required have to apply for all offences. So I do appreciate it's a somewhat complex area, and I'm happy to explore the detail further directly with Mr Green, but also as the bill progresses.
And supplementary, Lee McArthur.
Thank you, President Officer. Can I belatedly welcome the Cabinet Secretary to her post? Can I also welcome the publication of the bill and support the general thrust in terms of the removal of not proven, which will be aware of the concerns around the impact this then does have on juries. Now, the government's carried out quite a bit of research in terms of mock jury research, but I'm aware that Professor Thomas at University College London has actually carried out research with real juries in different areas. And I wonder whether the government is willing to explore, even at this late stage, engaging with UCL, with Professor Thomas, to undertake further research with real juries on the potential impacts and the confusion she's referred to.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, can I start by assuring Mr McArthur that the research that was undertaken that was specific to Scotland was indeed extensive, and there is also extensive research elsewhere in Europe too. But of course it is important that as we progress with this landmark legislation that we have a debate in and around all aspects of the bill that is of the very highest of standards, and of course I would expect Parliament and indeed committees to be looking at a full range of evidence, and certainly on behalf of the government, we are always open to exploring all evidence, because it's imperative that if we are determined to put victims very much at the heart of our criminal justice system, that we have to be focused on what works and what works in the real world.
Question number two, Claire Baker.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had with the Scottish Law Commission regarding its view on the law on homicide in relation to culpable homicide.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, ministers meet regularly with the chair of the Scottish Law Commission to discuss their work programme in general. The last such meeting was held in December 2022.
Claire Baker.
Thank you. Gary Robertson from Cowdenbeath died in 2019 as a result of falling from a platform while working at Longannet Power Station. Following Gary's death, the demolition firm Brown & Mason were fined just £5,000 in a criminal prosecution. The family received no apology from the company. They were not even allowed to make a statement in court, as it was a health and safety prosecution. The £5,000 did not cover the cost of Gary's funeral. Through a civil case, Mr Robertson's family did receive damages, but families who lose loved ones at work should not have to rely on civil cases, which diminishes their loss. And Gary's wife, Karen, has said, "We need to make sure the laws designed to hold people accountable can't be manipulated to let those responsible escape justice. The first thing Gary's employers sent to me wasn't a sympathy card or a phone call, it was his P45. So as we approach International Workers' Memorial Day, can I ask what the Cabinet Secretary will do to ensure that families like Gary's can get justice, given that no cases in Scotland have been prosecuted under the Corporate Manslaughter and Homicide Act 2007?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I recognise Ms Baker's long-standing and committed interest in this area. There are, of course, existing laws which can be used, such as the Common Law of Homicide, the Health and Safety at Work Act, and, of course, Corporate Manslaughter and Corporate Homicide Act 2007. It is important, just for information, to say that since 2009, 13 cases have been reported to the Crown Office in respect of corporate homicide as well as other charges. Of those cases, 9 have resulted in convictions in court, 3 remain under consideration by the Crown Office, and 1 led to no further action. And whilst she is correct to say that there have been no convictions under the 2007 Act, these cases that I refer to have resulted in guilty pleas to breaches in other legislation, such as the Health and Safety at Work Act. But it is an area that I would be more than happy to continue to engage with Ms Baker on.
Question number 3, Ronan Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its strategy is for protecting autistic women from sexual violence.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We are fully committed to protecting all women from violence as part of our commitment to the Equally Safe Strategy. The Autism and Learning and Intellectual Disability Transformation Plan Towards Transformation sets out to shape supports, services and attitudes to ensure that human rights of autistic people and people with learning and intellectual disabilities are respected and protected, and that they are empowered to live their lives the same as everyone else.
Rona McKay.
Thank the Minister for that answer. A recent report revealed that 90% of autistic women are victims of sex attacks, and very few of these are reported to the police. The Scottish Women's Autism Network have teamed up with Police Scotland to raise awareness and create strategies to help. Does the Minister believe that an early diagnosis of their condition would help women to cope and may prevent them becoming victims in the first place?
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I do. Firstly, it's essential that perpetrators of sexual violence are held to account and on the onus for change and action is focused on the perpetrator and not the victim. That is why our Equally Safe Strategy prioritises robust responses to perpetrators and changes to attitudes which allow this behaviour. And the member is correct. Support for survivors is also vital. A diagnosis can be essential to enabling an autistic person to access relevant information and support. And we encourage all victims of sexual violence to report crimes and welcome Police Scotland's work to better understand with those with neurological divergence to ensure victims are treated respectfully.
Question number four, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, to ask the Scottish Government what support it can provide to families of veterans.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government fully recognises the importance of supporting the families of veterans where they face challenges as a result of service or from events such as transition to civilian life. As such, we seek to incorporate them into our support to veterans wherever possible. For example, the partners and spouse of veterans are eligible for veterans' employability support, such as the Going Forward into Employment Scheme, and we fund the National Education Officer role to support both service children and the children of veterans, and projects supporting veterans' families are eligible for funding through the Scottish Veterans Fund.
Christine Graham.
I thank the Minister for her answer. Now, I appreciate this isn't perhaps your portfolio now. Wives and partners of serving people serving the armed forces, such as in my constituency at Glencorse Barracks, they find it very difficult because of regular relocation to sustain employment. Is there a role for Women's Enterprise Scotland, for example, to assist partners to establish their own businesses, which they can take with them as they move around?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will get back on that specific point, but I did want to raise that inspired by the Scottish Government's supported Can Do Places programme, the Lucas Co Working Hub for Spouses and Partners opened in 2017. It was the first hub in which now became the Military Co-Working Network, a network of co-working spaces close to military bases throughout the UK. And the criteria for Women's Return to Programme, which assists women who have been out of work for 6-odd months to successfully enter the workforce, was extended to include female veterans and spouses and partners and service personnel. Skills Development Scotland continues to work with service and veteran families to provide careers information, advice and guidance. And for example, SDS advisors work once a month at community centres in Helensburgh and are considering how to set up regular opportunities across Scotland, including at the borders. And I know that Mr Day, the Minister for Veterans, would be happy to meet Christine Graham to discuss that further.
A supplementary, Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Glasgow's Helping Heroes, run by SAFA, offer a vital service across Greater Glasgow, offering holistic support to veterans and their families via their one-stop shop in Govan. And for every £1 invested in that service, Glasgow's Helping Heroes delivers £6.63 of social value back into the Scottish economy. So can I ask the Minister what assessment the Scottish Government has made of this particular service and whether it will consider allocating funds to scale up the programme to provide support for veterans across Scotland as a model of exemplar quality?
Minister.
I thank the member for that question. I do not have that information at hand, but I'm happy to write to you regarding that.
And supplementary, Willie Rennie.
Yeah, I can attest that the Lookers Project Working Hub is a fantastic exercise. The education of children of veterans and armed forces is characterised by constant disruption as the families move from base to base. In England, there is a pupil premium specifically for service children. Should there be a similar one for Scotland, in addition to the pupil equity fund, to help those very children here?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The National Education Office for Children and Young People of Armed Forces Families, which is funded by the Scottish Government, has been undertaking a national data collection exercise with accompanying analysis to help put together an accurate picture of the distribution and number of service children in Scotland. And the data and reports collated from this exercise will be shared more widely with key stakeholders and used to improve educational outcomes for service children and young people.
Thank you. Question number five, Audrey Nicholson.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what progress is being made in the use of diversion from prosecution in Scotland.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, decisions relating to prosecution policy, including the decision to offer diversion from prosecution, are of course matters for the Lord Advocate as independent prosecutor. However, with diversion cases at the highest level in the last decade, noting some caution given to the impact of COVID-19, we welcome the recent Joint Inspectorate review report into diversion from prosecution and will work with justice partners to consider the recommendations outlined. We know diversion can allow individuals to address a range of issues or needs which have contributed to their alleged offending behaviour at the earliest opportunity, helping to improve outcomes for individuals and keeping communities safe.
Audrey Nicholl.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Diversion from prosecution provides an accused person with support to address the underlying causes of their behaviour. And as the Cabinet Secretary has outlined, diversion cases commenced rose by 12% between 2019-20 and 2020-21. As the Cabinet Secretary also referred to, a joint review of diversion from prosecution found that while some community justice partnerships expressed readiness to respond to an anticipated increase in referrals, others were less confident about their capacity to manage an increase on the backdrop of already stretched resources. So given future reform of, for example, bail and release from custody is likely to see additional demands on community justice agencies, and while I acknowledge prosecution policy is a matter for the Lord Advocate, can the Cabinet Secretary provide an assurance that the Scottish Government will review funding arrangements to maximise use of diversion at the earliest opportunity, as was recommended in the report?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government is committed to supporting community justice services as part of our wider focus on reducing crime and reoffending. We continue to protect the community justice budget, and in 2023-24 we will invest a total of £134 million in community justice, and this includes £123 million to local authority justice social work services for the provision of community interventions. And this investment contributes to our long-standing aim to encourage a shift in the balance between the use of custody and justice in community, where that is appropriate, of course, reflecting evidence that community interventions can be more effective at reducing reoffending and assisting with rehabilitation than short-term custodial sentences. However, we do very much recognise the challenging budgetary situation for our delivery partners, including local authorities, and we will continue to work in collaboration to maximise the use of available resources and understand the issues as they arise. And we, of course, very much welcome the Joint Inspectorate Review report into diversion from prosecution and will work with justice partners to consider the recommendations outlined and our response to those.
And supplementary, Russell Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. In the 3 years up until 2021, hundreds of alleged criminals caught by the police then rejected the offer of a fiscal fine as an alternative to prosecution. Having done so, they faced no further action. This is despite the previous Deputy First Minister telling Parliament that a refusal would be treated as, and I quote, a request by the alleged offender to be prosecuted. Now, such smoke and mirrors can only shake public faith in Scottish justice. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell me if those who refuse are now being prosecuted, and provide the most recent figures for comparison?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm sure I don't need to repeat that prosecution and all matters in and around that are, of course, matters for the Lord Advocate and the Crown Office. I will accept the point in relation to our justice system that if the justice system says we are going to follow a course of action, it is important that we follow through on intent. And I will look at the matter Mr Finlay has raised with me today and will seek to provide him with further information.
Question number six, Alexander Burnett.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many police stations have been closed down in the area covered by Police Scotland's North East Division since the force's foundation in 2013.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Police Scotland has confirmed that 21 facilities have been closed since 2013 across the North East Division area. It should be noted that five of these closures relate to relocations in the same area, with a further two locations acquired in Aberdeen. Service provision is carefully considered by Police Scotland prior to any decision being made, including consultation. Moving officers to modern co-located accommodation supports the long-term vision of policing, which includes enhanced partnership working and responding to the changing needs of communities, while also maintaining visibility and public confidence.
Alexander Burnett.
This month, Police Scotland celebrates its 10th anniversary, but the SNP's centralisation project has come at the cost of local police on the ground. In my constituency, Kemeny Police Station's closure is keenly felt, and as the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, a quarter of all Scottish police counters have shut since the force merged in 2013, and there are plans for more to go. 73 divisional officers have been lost from the North East region, all thanks to SNP neglect. So what can the Cabinet Secretary tell my constituents who contact me with increasing cases of antisocial behaviour, vandalism, theft and drug abuse, all due to a reduced police presence?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it is important that Mr Burnett tells his constituents that this government, since 2017-18, has doubled the capital budget available to Police Scotland, that it now amounts to around £50 million. It's also important to stress that police stations do, of course, remain important, but these are, as he well knows, matters for Police Scotland and the Scottish Police Authority, particularly in relation to the implementation of their estate strategy that was published in 2019. And I think most people would recognise the importance of co-location of public services and how this improves partnership and collaborative working, which is to all the benefit to improving safety for communities the length and breadth of Scotland. And Mr Burnett might be interested to know that by the end of 2022 that there are now 64 co-locations, and that is currently 21% of the Police Scotland estate, and that surely has to be a move forward.
Question number seven, Pam Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Justice Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding action to prevent child sexual exploitation.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, keeping children safe from sexual exploitation and abuse is a key priority for the Scottish Government, and I will be meeting with the Minister for Children and Young People in the coming weeks to discuss this matter further. We are committed to ensuring robust child protection measures are in place, and we are working with partners to prevent abuse and intervene so risk and harm to children and young people is recognised early and acted on quickly and effectively. And this includes online harms, and we continue to press the UK Government to ensure its online safety bill provides robust protection for children and holds the technology industry to account.
Pam Gozo.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In my region, East Dumbartonshire, the number of crimes recorded as indecent photos of children increased by 140% since 2017 and 200% in from the year ending 2021. There are a lot of actions that can be taken in the short term to prevent the tidal wave of this horrendous crime. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what preventive action the Scottish Government is taking and how the effectiveness of those actions is being measured?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Ms Goswell raises some very important points, particularly in and around measuring the effectiveness of interventions. It's something that I am closely interested in, not just in the justice portfolio, but it is a germane matter for all Scottish Government ministers who have responsibilities in this area. In terms of the action that we are taking forward, she will be aware of the revised National Guidance for Child Protection in Scotland that was published in 2021, and that provides the most up-to-date information on the work to tackle child sexual abuse and exploitation, and the support that is taking place in local areas like hers to develop effective evidence-based responses. Our overall response as a government is, of course, framed by the promise, the UNCRC and Scotland's GIRFEC approach, and of course the matters she raises in and around the sexual abuse and exploitation of children on online platforms is, of course, important, and it is a matter that we will continue to engage constructively and collaboratively with the UK Government, bearing in mind where some of these powers rest.
And I can squeeze in question number 8, if I can get please succinct questions and answers to match. Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how many people who have been sentenced for a crime were aged under 25 when they pled guilty or were found guilty since 26 January 2022.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, data is only currently available up to the end of 2022. From 26 January 2022 to the 31st of December 2022, 10,725 offenders who have been sentenced for a crime were under the age of 25 when they pled guilty or were found guilty. It should be noted that where an offender is subject to multiple separate proceedings, that offender will be counted multiple times.
Murdo Fraser.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Without referencing any particular case, the Cabinet Secretary will be aware there is widespread public concern that under current sentencing guidelines, someone convicted of raping a 13-year-old girl could avoid prison and be given a non-custodial sentence because they were under 25 at the time of the offence. Now, I know that sentencing guidelines are set independently of Scottish ministers, but ultimately this Parliament has the power to set sentencing, and in particular set minimum sentences for offences, as it has done in a number of cases. So does the Cabinet Secretary think it is acceptable that a convicted rapist should not be sent to prison? And if not, what is she going to do about it?
And before I ask the Cabinet Secretary to respond, I of course would remind all members that this that a case that may have been seen to have been referred to in Mr Fraser's question is a live case, and any references thereto should take into account the law applicable to such references. Thank you.
Presiding Officer, for the avoidance of doubt, as Justice Secretary, I will not be commenting on live cases, either individual offenders that are either in the community or indeed within our prison establishment. Can I assure Mr Fraser that I have a long history in and around the need to tackle sexual offending. It is important to recognise the legislative framework that was passed by this Parliament that frames the duties and responsibilities of the Sentencing Council. It is also important to put on the record that in terms of the sentencing guidelines for young people, that nothing prohibits the use of punishment or indeed imprisonment as matters that inform the sentencing of undertaken by our independent judiciary. It is also, I should say, matters of rape are dealt with in the High Court, and that the High Court has unlimited powers in this matter and indeed can use life sentencing for rape convictions as well. And I hope it would be at least of some assurance to Mr Fraser that 98% of all rape convictions across all age groups in Scotland result in a custodial sentence.
And very brief supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is the view of His Majesty's Inspectorate of Prisons for Scotland that young offenders' institutions are inappropriate forbearance. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what steps are being taken to ensure that young offenders have access to appropriate care and, where deemed necessary, appropriate secure accommodation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, where it is decided that it is appropriate for a child under 18 to be deprived of their liberty, it is the view of this government that they should be placed in secure accommodation as opposed to a young offenders institution. And that is on the basis of our commitments in and around the promise, the UNCRC. These are cross-party and cross-parliamentary commitments. And it is also important to put on record that secure accommodation, where deprivation of liberty is required, is the best place to manage risk and needs of high-risk young offenders.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on justice and veterans. And before we move on to the next item of business, there will be a very short pause to allow front bench teams to shift positions should they wish. Thank you.